The next speaker is Fabian Kindler about the punk rock gimmick scenes here in the Isabel Hall and his work together with John.
Yes, thanks for the introduction. Can everybody hear me? Sounds okay, good. So this talk will be about, in the beginning, I'm going to talk about ODEs and the formalization thereof and the tools we have for ODEs in Isabel. Then I'm going to come to a formalization of the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, which was mostly joint work with Yong Kiam, who's also here in the audience, the second from the back row. First of all, ODEs, why do we care about them? ODEs provide mathematical models of real-world phenomena. So you can model physics, for example. You can model the position x of a ball that's falling with velocity v, which accelerates with gravitational constant g, for example. In this very simple model, one can give an explicit solution to this, to the ODE, and from this one can deduce properties of the ball, how the ball falls, just from looking at those explicit solutions. In general, and already for a slightly more complicated example of an ODE, the model of glycolysis, for example, this model does not exhibit any explicit solutions. So the question is, how can we deduce properties about this model without actually knowing anything about the solution? So one nice thing about ODEs is you can visualize them. So this is an ODE on the plane, and there you can visualize the behavior by observing that the differential equation x prime and y prime gives the direction and rate of change, how the system evolves. So an ODE is essentially a vector field, so you see all of those arrows, and at one specific point, one specific state, the ODE prescribes how the system evolves, in which direction. And now, how can one gain knowledge about solutions of ODEs? One thing is simulations. So starting from some initial point, sort of following the arrows that the ODE prescribes, is what I call simulation. This is because this following these arrows is sort of an infinitesimal process. So such a simulation will always be somewhat approximate. So you always incur some errors there. Something a bit more rigorous, called rigorous numerics or rigorous numerical simulations. There, I'm not sure if you can see it here. So the idea is that we compute some geometrical shapes that are, that by construction, are guaranteed to contain the solution of the ODE. So everyone has more guarantees, but one restriction of this approach and also of studying ODEs with simulations is that one can only follow these solutions only up to a finite time bound. And one thing that one can observe for this model of glycolysis is that there's interesting behavior for infinite time, or for limiting time behavior. So this is outer blue, the solutions from this outer blue point, for example, it looks like from looking at these simulations that they converge toward this red, what I call limit cycle. So this looks like a periodic solution. And also this point in the middle looks like it tends towards this limit cycle. But the question is, with simulations and also with rigorous numerics, it's impossible to say that this visualization or what looks like limiting behavior, we won't be able to verify that because it's behavior for infinite time. But there are some techniques with which one can deduce such properties directly from looking at the equations. So not really reasoning about the solutions, but looking at the equations directly. And so for the rest of the talk today, I want to talk about two things. One is the first part is going to be about formalization of ODEs in Isabel in general, just to give you sort of an overview of what kind of techniques and results we have there, with some of the main theorem in this part, what rigorous numerical methods that we can compute an enclosure, here gray and here gray, that's guaranteed to contain a solution starting from some initial point. For the other part of the talk, I'm going to focus on a theorem that we recently formalized. It's the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, which establishes, under some mild assumption, limiting behavior of ODEs or of solutions. What's interesting about this theorem and what's challenging about formalizing it is that a key lemma in proving that theorem relies on textbook proofs often look like this. It's just an image. This is the proof of the crucial lemma in here. And it's also in Hartmann's textbook, and another textbook, you see a picture like this.
It's the same proof.
It's the same proof, yeah. This one's a bit different, but still looks similar. The same, and here, my all-time favorite, leaving the proof as an exercise with the hint, draw a picture. So it's going to be fun to formalize. But yeah, we come to that first. I'm going to say a few words about the background formalization of ODEs and what kind of techniques we have there. For ODEs, usually assume that they're given by a right-hand side F, and we have sort of a hierarchy of results for F being locally Lipschitz, for autonomous ODEs, non-autonomous ODEs, C1 right-hand side. Basic results, existence and uniqueness of solutions. So a solution, I will usually denote this by phi, so this will come up more often during the talk. Solution phi starting from x0, that would be the initial point, at some time t. And the solution satisfies the initial condition, and the time derivative is given by the right-hand side. One challenge in formalizing this is, especially when formalizing it in Isabel HOL, so this uniqueness, this unique solution is constructed as a fixed point of Picard iteration, which is an operator on a function space that looks very much like a dependent type, so on a time interval. So looks like it's challenging for doing it in non-dependently typed Isabel HOL, but one can encode it essentially in a somewhat bigger space that's non-dependent. Some other basic results is that the flow, there's a group action of this real value time on the flow, so one can flow for some time s, and from that point for some time t. It's the same as flowing for time s plus t. It's just a group property of the flow. What?
Do you have assumptions that mean that flows at
time? Yes, that's written here. So one thing that's nice is that one can reason about sort of combining solutions very nicely algebraically. It's a bit tedious is that one always needs to carry around assumption that the flow is actually defined at those times where one's using it. Another thing, the flow is differentiable, so one can, there's a linear approximation to sort of deviations in the initial value. From a formalization point of view, which is, what is a bit interesting or challenging is that the derivative of the flow is itself given as the solution of a differential equation. And this differential equation, the variational equation, is sort of a matrix-valued differential equation. So one somewhat needs a module system that allows to accommodate for that. And I sort of sketched this here. So there's sort of a module for ODEs, in which we define a solution and properties about those solutions. And then inside this module, we sort of start another module for the variational equation, so another ODE, which is in this case matrix valued. And then we sort of want all of the results that we had for this original ODE, or all of the results that we had there. We want them for the variational equation, and then sort of export and reuse them to reason about the original solution here. So saying that the derivative of the solution is equal to the solution of the variational equation. So it requires some flexibility in working with those different modules and things like that. Something else. So we also have some techniques to reason about hybrid systems. Hybrid systems, I mean systems that combine continuous and discrete behavior, where the continuous behavior is given by ODEs. So think again of this falling ball. This behavior is, like when you look at it from a real world point of view, this behavior is only valid as long as the position of the ball is, as long as the ball is actually above the floor. Because once it hits the floor, there's some discrete control kicking in that says, okay, the ball bounces back with the negative speed, perhaps damped by some constant. So that's the motivation for hybrid systems. Mathematically, the main tool to talk about these or such discrete switches is the Poincaré map. The discrete switch takes place at something like this green Poincaré section. So that's just, in general, it's a smooth hypersurface in your state space. And this is sort of where the ball hits the floor. In textbooks, so textbooks usually make their life easy by defining this Poincaré map in a setting where it's obvious that it's defined and how it is defined. So textbooks usually introduce Poincaré maps for periodic orbits. And then the return time, which is the time till, say, point starting here, returns back to the Poincaré section. In this case, it's easily defined. It's just the period of the periodic orbit. And then one can define the Poincaré map or the return time in a neighborhood around that point simply by solving the return time with the implicit function theorem. So this gives you the time for all values in this neighborhood. You know that, you know, like how to modify the time such that you precisely return to this Poincaré section. We formalized a slightly more general and more widely applicable definition. They're saying that the return time is actually what the name says, the time until a point returns back to the section. It's defined as something that hits the section, and for all earlier times, it doesn't hit the section. This, in some ways, complicates things, because with this definition, the return time is not continuous everywhere, because if you start from below the section, the return time is very high. If you start above, then the return time is actually close to zero. So you need to cope with this discontinuity there. But on the plus side, this definition holds essentially for all points that actually return to the Poincaré section. So this was a very high level overview about what kind of abstract results we have about ODEs, unique solutions, flows, a notion of Poincaré map. This has been used in several different applications. Interestingly, many about hybrid systems, so in formally verified differential dynamic logic, people have verified hybrid systems with modal Kini algebra, with this ODE formalization as foundation, and also verification of cyber physical systems. I think that says something about, I would claim that this says that the library of ODEs that we have is in a reasonably good state, because for most of those works, I only knew about the fact that people were using the library after they published their papers and have worked on it and built on it. So that means, they could use it without help from an expert. We have these abstract results, but there's still some discrepancy. So how one wants to reason about solutions, because usually, or what many people do is just they look at simulations and then say, okay, looks like the system behaves like this and that. But simulations are very, they're not directly amenable to formalization, because there are those, all of those approximation errors, which are hard to quantify. Could we formalize simulations? In principle, yes, one could formalize something like the simulation, the error between the simulation and the actual solution grows exponentially, and one can choose a small time step and everything converges. But in practice, this is the error bounds that one gets are overly pessimistic and is not really usable. Therefore, one approach is, or what one can do, rigorous numerics, is to propagate such error bounds on the fly, because especially when one has a stable system, this tends to damp the errors that one has. And the overall technique is very much, so it can be used like a simulation, so you can use it like as a black box technique, just input your ODE, click a button, and then you get some enclosure for the behavior. So it's easily usable like a simulation, but it's rigorous. So you know that those bounds are actually correct. You can compute something like this, starting from some initial point. You get some sequence of geometrical shapes that are guaranteed to contain the true solution. And as I said, it's actually formally verified, and what we can see perhaps here is that it's also not, somewhat like a, it's close to a push button technique. So it doesn't take much more boilerplate effort to set up everything compared to doing a simulation in MATLAB, for example. So here on the first couple of lines, I define the ODE, then there's some boilerplate. Then here I say this ODE is actually sort of well-defined in the sense that it's locally Lipschitz continuous or C1 can be proven automatically. Then I can prove some actual concrete bounds, numerical bounds on the behavior of this solution. And yeah, the tactic will spit out some sequence of numbers. This is what I've used here to plot those bounds. But yeah, one can also use it to prove theorems using those bounds. I'm not going to go into the technical details of how to formalize and verify this. So verification is mostly refinement. One application of this, or just as an example of what we can use this rigorous numerical ODE solver for, is Smale's 14th problem. Was something conjectured by Edward Lorenz in the 60s, a three-dimensional ODE where simulations looked like it's a chaotic system, but one couldn't prove it. Tucker, 2002, said, yes, it's actually chaotic. And he proved it with roughly one paragraph, which combines standard results from dynamical systems theory, 25 pages of his PhD thesis about normal form theory. So this is analysis and form power series. And he also wrote a C++ program, which he described on 24 pages in his PhD thesis, consisting of lots of lines of C++ code. And this computed essentially some bounds and what he used for the proof. So this is part of the output of his computer program. And from this, he concluded some global properties from which, with these standard reasoning techniques, he could conclude that the system is chaotic. Funnily, this is from Tucker's webpage. So after publishing, he had a couple of revisions to his, in particular to his code, not to his proof, but to his code. So he found some bugs in his code. I think, I mean, the computations in the end are all correct, but it's not very nice to have bugs in a computer program that should prove something. And this is what I was able to use the verified ODE solver for, namely to verify the computations that Tucker did for his proof about Smale's problem. Then one can conclude formally in Isabel these properties about the return map that are necessary for Tucker's proof. To summarize some of those rigorous numerical results, so it's a theorem that tells us that the computed enclosures actually contain the solution. This can be used as a push button technique. It's been used in several applications, including Smale's 14th problem. We've used it as part of a motion planning software for autonomous vehicles, and also participated in the ARCH, stands for Applied Verification of Continuous and Hybrid Systems. Successfully participated in a software competition with this tool. Some problems with rigorous numerical techniques in general is that all of these computations, they can only work with concrete values, and everything needs to be bounded, instead of concrete bounds. And also you can do these computations only for a finite time horizon. So if you have something, some behavior for infinite time, then you're lost with those rigorous numerical tools. And so we want to go a bit into the direction of being able to analyze systems with interesting behavior for infinite time. And yeah, we decided to formalize the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem. So what does this say? So here at this example, see simulations. And what we see, or yeah, what the simulations show is one periodic orbit, this red one. And it looks like all other solutions, like solutions from the outside, spiral around this and tend toward the periodic solution, and solutions from the inside spiral outward and also tend toward the solution. So, and the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem gives a way of rigorously proving that this is actually the case and not just an artifact of numerical simulations. So what are some of the formalization challenges that occur there? So the theorem has substantial prerequisites, so requires lots of formalized mathematics as a background. It requires the Jordan curve theorem, for example, lots of real analysis, and also ODEs. In a way, that was an easy formalization challenge because all of this was available in Isabel, HOL, and in the AFP. So we essentially had most of the foundational theories. Another thing is, so it's a theorem from, dynamical systems. So it needs a formalization of dynamical systems concepts. So limit sets, periodic orbits, things like that. But this is also relatively easy because it's just straightforward formalizing definitions and arguments in textbooks that we can follow more or less line by line. Yeah.
I have a question about the challenge because you haven't shown us the actual statement of Poincaré-Bendixson, and do you actually formalize something where you put extra assumption making this theorem true, or do you formalize the actual Poincaré-Bendixson?
We formalize the actual Poincaré-Bendixson theorem in several variants. So there's a special one, a more general one. I think I have some formal statements coming up.
Okay. I would say the formal statement is also challenging. The actual one, not.
Yeah, we'll see it. Not too much. I mean, it requires formalizing several of these foundational concepts, but then we can write it down. as I said already in the beginning, for a key lemma, textbooks rely heavily on sketches like these, this, or this. And it was challenging to figure out how to formalize those sketches in Proof Assistant. And another point, point number four, is that many proofs argue by symmetry and obviously only present one case and omit all of the symmetric cases. And turned out to be challenging to formalize these symmetries without just duplicating all of the proofs. So coming up with some infrastructure to deal with these symmetries. I want to say something about this key lemma that consisted of all of those geometric sketches. The lemma is this monotonicity lemma that I stated in the beginning. which says that if a trajectory intersects a transversal segment, it does so monotonically in the order of the segment. First of all, what is a transversal segment? It's essentially a Poincaré section where the right-hand side of the ODE is nowhere zero. So the flow passes through this segment. And so perhaps at this picture I can explain more what the monotonicity dilemma says. So it says if a flow, for example, starting here, intersects a transversal segment, so AB is the transversal segment, intersects it here for the first time, loops around, intersects it for a second time. And then what the lemma says that is that future intersections will be ordered along this line segment. So the third intersection will be between X2 and B. The proof goes like this. Assuming this situation, construct a Jordan curve consisting of this part of the trajectory and this part of the line segment. Jordan curve theorem separates this into an inside and an outside. And then goes on by saying that, a future intersection must happen in the inside because the flow cannot flow to the outside, because then one would need to cross the trajectory, which would contradict the uniqueness of solutions, and the flow can also not exit the Jordan curve through this line segment because the flow points in one direction on the line segment, in this case upward. So this is sort of the main argument. Then there are several symmetric cases. For example, so we had this case where we flow from the outside to the inside, but there's also the case where we flow from the inside of the Jordan curve to the outside, and then the next intersection will also be on the outside. There's also the case where the flow stays outside before sort of making the first intersection, or it remains inside before it. So those are sort of four symmetric cases. In all of the textbook proofs, there's sort of a subtle claim that these are actually the only possibilities that can occur. And so this is something that one also has to prove and establish, that this is actually the case distinction that one needs to make. And to do this, we realize that there are sort of three pieces of information that one needs to establish simultaneously. Part one, which is the easiest, is that the flow always crosses from the outside to the inside on this part of the line segment. The second part is that this segment from A to X1 is on the outside, and the flow locally here is on the inside. And so the most important part being that simultaneously establishing that this part and this part lie on opposite sides of the Jordan curve. How we established these properties in the end, we devised something that we call a flow region construction. Was somewhat inspired by one of the textbook proofs that we saw, that we've seen, but it's only inspired by that. It's very different in the end. And the key idea, the construction that we make is sort of flowing all points on the segment from A to X2 backward for some small but finite time, and flowing points from the segment from X1 to B forward for some small but finite time. And then we have these connected regions And on these regions, because they are connected, and then with continuity, one can reason and establish all of those properties that one requires there. So this huge construction that I showed here was only for this, so for one of those four symmetric cases. So I need to obtain all of the other cases as well. One thing is that reversing the direction of the flow helps to sort of obtain or to reduce the cases to one another. And this is again something where we make use of the module system of Isabelle, or the locale system, where this helped a lot. So obtaining results about the reversed flow. So in a context where we have an ODE, and then there's a solution phi, for example, and if we have some theorem mentioning the solution, then we sort of go into a submodule for the reverse flow, in which we get a theorem about the reverse flow. And then we can export these results by rewriting with the fundamental equality between flow and reverse flow, namely that the reverse flow is the original flow in negative time. And then we get a theorem about where time is flipped. Yeah. A theorem formalized is nice and good, but it's also good to know that one can actually apply it. So I want to say a few words about what we needed to apply to one concrete application. So this is a special case of the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, assuming that there's a compact set K in which the flow is positively invariant. So the flow doesn't leave this compact set. And when there's no fixed point in the compact set and some other assumption, then there's a limit cycle. And the limit cycle is contained in this K. So to prove the positively invariant part, we formalize some comparison principles or barrier certificates, things that we've seen yesterday in Sean's presentation. So there the idea is to prove that a set, this here, is positively invariant. So one needs to compute derivatives and show that things are continuous, which is easy. And then with the third assumption, one is left with essentially something, some real arithmetic formula.
What is
zero? That's the solution or the flow of the ODE. It's called flow zero, I don't know why. Because it's the solution. The fourth assumption, it says the flow from X for time t is not in K. So when you use this, so this X in this example is here, the point on the bottom, and the flow for some negative time is outside of K. And so this gives us the property that there's a solution starting from outside. So essentially it says that there is something which is not the limit cycle, something that approaches the limit cycle. So the solution from this point X here approaches the limit cycle. So here we are left with some arithmetic goal, which in some cases
we could prove with the SOS method. Example here. In other cases, the arithmetic that one is left with to prove is too complicated for the SOS method. They resorted to some branch and bound techniques using affine arithmetic. So essentially subdividing the state space and proving the property on each of those subdivisions separately. And yeah, to establish this fourth property that there's something from outside flowing or approaching the limit cycle, we use these reachability analysis techniques. So reachability analysis from this point backwards, then we know that, for example, from here, we enter the invariant region. Let me conclude. So yeah, formulate the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem. Isabel and the AFP had all of the prerequisites that we needed. Yongqiang, whose first, so this was Yongqiang's first serious Isabel HOL project. And he said that Sledgehammer was very, very useful to search and find lemmas in the libraries. About sketches, these sketchy textbook proofs, we give what we think the first fully rigorous argument for this proof step, or at least one that's amenable to formalization. When we prepared the slides, we actually came across a proof in textbook by Cronin, which looks more rigorous than most of the others, but I think this can only be judged after trying to formalize this argument, and this is something we haven't done. Make use of the locale system to reason about these symmetric cases. One question is, our proof is very different from these textbook sketches, and we wonder if this is unavoidable. Should there be cleaner or more abstract proofs? We think so. I don't know. Another question is, how easy would it be to, could we do this formalization in another proof assistant as well? Probably depends on the prerequisite libraries. I also wanted to say something about, the role of the proof assistant in this. We're mostly agnostic with respect to the foundation, so it doesn't matter that it's HOL. It could also be some type theory. And I think we don't use any deeply prover-specific formalization tricks. There are some formalization tricks that I won't go into detail here, but so you can look at the paper, and it's nothing that's really specific to the prover. It's just formalization in general. And I think the most important part why we did it in Isabel was the libraries that we had. But also the available automation was important. So Sledgehammer for library search, some of Square's method to get rid of arithmetic goals, the reachability analysis to gain some insights about solutions of OBEs. What would have been nice would have been real arithmetic CAD, what we've seen a bit earlier, to solve those arithmetic goals. I think I'm going to stop here. Thank you.
John Kraft theorem is in two dimensions. So does that mean that you are doing it in two dimensions, or is there some other?
So the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem is a theorem just for ODEs in the plane. The general dynamical systems concepts, those are for arbitrary dimensions, and we formalize all of the properties that hold in arbitrary dimension and arbitrary dimension, but Jordan Kerr theorem restricts everything to 2D. Yeah.
Okay, do you see much potential
generalize what we do to make the sort of general purpose similar to operators?
So I think the general purpose operators that we use here is the locale system of Isabel, so system to deal with modules. And there are some features that help in exploiting such symmetries. So yeah, doing sublocales and when exporting from sublocales, rewriting with certain equalities. So those features are helpful and useful. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, in the end, yeah. Very generally, it's probably locales in Isabel, and then domain specific. I don't know. We are just trying to get symmetric theorems with as little effort as possible.
One last question. So, you found many books that all had proof by picture.
Yes.
And is it always the same picture?
More or less, yeah.
So, do you think they were just? Do you think actually, in some sense, this argument is rigorous, and people are using some sort of synthetic two-dimensional geometry facts?
Yeah,
they're just copying each other and nobody's being lazy.
Well, I think already Bendixson has this picture in his original paper.
Do you think it's actually a proof?
I think it's a proof. I think it's a proof. I think there could be some abstractions that one could use in this case, but we didn't figure something out. I don't know, perhaps synthetic topology, things like that. I don't know. But we haven't found anything.
So I guess you mentioned the locality that you had. How much of that do you think would transfer over to another theory that you have locality? Or like,
so the thing is, I don't know much about module systems in Lean, for example. There isn't one. Perhaps something like that would be useful.
Thank you, speaker again.